So just to provide an overview of the Construction Innovation Hub and the four-year programme from the UK's perspective, and maybe align with some of the discussion points that we've already heard today, especially around quality and some of the things we're doing to try and help. So that's me. The vision for the Construction Innovation Hub was that we were launched in 2018.
Sorry, Steve, hello? Do you want to share your screen?
Oh, sorry, I thought I'd done that.
No, okay, no problem.
I had shared it, apologies.
Yeah.
Just 1 second, sorry.
No problem at all.
For some reason,
Shannon could also share it.
Yeah, Shannon, can you try? Because I've hit the button from my side. Apologies, I did say I was having a few connection issues this morning. So are you able to do it, Shannon?
Yeah, sure. Give me 2 seconds.
Okay. No problem.
If you want to continue speaking there, Stephen, I'll try and get this up for you.
Okay. So as I said, my apologies for the disruption. So, yeah, we're a four-year program from the Innovation Transforming Construction Industrial Strategy Challenge Fund. And the challenge aims to transform the construction sector, enabling it to produce safer, healthier, efficient buildings using the latest digital manufacturing techniques. The hub envisages that a better world through a better built environment. Our mission is to be a catalyst for transforming the UK construction sector through manufacturing technologies and digital ways of working that are trusted and secured to boost productivity, exports, asset performance that will benefit society. Are we still struggling with the... Okay, I'll carry on. So, who are we? The Construction Hub brings together three world-class expertise from the Manufacturing Technology Centre in Coventry, BRE, and the Centre for Digital Built Britain, coming from Cambridge University. With the aim to transform the industry. We provide a complementary set of skills across the spectrum of manufacturing, digital, and the measurements and assessment of performance with some overlaps. The hub is organized in...
Yeah. Sorry, I just turned off my mic there. Sorry, Stephen. How are we getting on, Shannon?
Sorry, Stephen, did you send me your presentation? I don't
see. No, I haven't. Sorry, I'm sharing from mine, but I definitely shared it, so I'm not sure why it's not connected. My sincere apologies.
No, no, but you can continue. It's fine. Perfect. Yeah, if you can try there, but if not, we can certainly... Our point is everything.
Okay, yeah, so we'll share the slides afterward anyway, so hopefully this will make sense as I'm talking through it.
Yeah.
So the hub is organised in a way that will allow us to focus on the technical standards of work that are required and that are closely related to each other, working around the four core themes of value, manufacturing, assurance and digital. And the joined up programme will allow us to deploy new approaches in a phased way whilst continuously measuring, learning and adapting according to the evidence. The four main work strands have strong overlaps with each other, with the activity outside the hub. They are backed by an aligned communications and engagement programme and an impact-focused central management team around the core value, manufacturing, assurance and digital strands. Collaboration is highly important on this programme, and this is something we're not able to do on ourselves. And we're working closely with government, clients, industry and academia to deliver something that makes a big impact. We've mentioned already today the issue of COVID. So from the UK Construction Innovation Hub's point of view, this has just reinforced the need for transformation. The past few months have seen unprecedented challenges for the industry and the impact of which is yet to be realised. Construction also has an opportunity here to demonstrate the crucial outcomes it can deliver for society when it responds. And we've witnessed already the passion and determination and agility of the construction sector, which has stepped up to play its part in the national response to COVID. By collaborating to create the vital infrastructure, such as the Network for Life-Saving Nightingale Hospitals, we've already seen the UK construction industry at its very best, and we had a glimpse of what the future could look like if we renew our focus on the positive outcomes we can deliver for society. As the sector begins to take steps forward to recover from COVID, there is great opportunity for us to reset the direction of the industry and travel most by rooted firmly in a new and better way of doing things and not simply returning to business as usual. At the Hub, we are determined to play our part in the COVID response and recovery and continue our role as a catalyst for transforming the UK construction sector. The Hub strongly supports the Construction Leadership Council's roadmap to recovery and the sector plan launched on the 1st of June. This is a comprehensive plan which we will see the sector not only recover but emerge from the current crisis stronger and better. We've already begun to adapt our transformative programme to ensure that we can support the delivery of the CLC plan, in particular driving the adoption of digital and manufacturing technologies and processes underpinned by a truly value-based approach to decision-making. The Hub will be accelerating key areas of its transformative programme to ensure that recovery doesn't mean a return to how we do things at present or how we have done things, but rather how can we do things better in the future. Looking ahead, we will continue to work closely with the Construction Leadership Council, government and other partners to support the joined up recovery plan for the sector and put transformation at the heart. So to support delivery of this, the CLC sector recovery plan, we will accelerate some parts of our programme. And one of those is the technical solution part of the platform approach. Currently, the majority of the buildings in the UK are procured individually, designed conventionally and constructed on-site using traditional skills and materials. However, and as we've seen this morning, there are examples of how modern methods of construction are increasingly being used either through modular or volumetric solutions or different forms of off-site construction. Despite this progress, the solutions are not yet being deployed at scale. Not all clients are aware of us, of using them, nor are the solutions in use always suitable deployed across multiple building types. And I think that's one of the key messages I've taken from this morning as well. The Hub will work with industry to identify and co-develop a platform solution that can be designed, manufactured and installed on a structural carrier frame and is able to be used across multiple building types. The platform design programme within the Hub builds on the government's ambition of infrastructure and projects authorities call for evidence around platform-based design for manufacturers and assembly. It is co-developed with industrial partners to create a new and integrated digitally enabled manufacturing components and sub-assemblies. As part of the Hub's programme, we've recently released the construction quality planning. One of the themes that's been mentioned time and time again this morning is the issue of quality, and one of the ways we're looking to address this in the UK is through this construction quality planning process. So, and you'll be able to, through the slides, pick up a link to the documentation and the guidance, and also get involved in the consultation process if you wish going forward. So CQP, as it's abbreviated to, provides a structured quality planning process for introducing new products from the conception phase through to manufacturing and first-time installation. The CQP applies to products being manufactured and delivered at scale, higher production volumes, using manufacturing-led construction approaches such as off-site, modern methods of construction, and DFMA, or Design for Manufacturing Assembly. The process builds on from advanced product quality planning, an established and recognised methodology employed through the manufacturing sector on a global scale to effectively build in the quality into the new complex products being brought to market. Now an ingrained process in the manufacturing sector, APQP supported a shift from a defect check culture to a defect prevention led approach. Many of the tools included within the APQP can be adapted to construction, providing improved quality and therefore addressing the identified bottlenecks for the sector. Okay, so to support that, we have an enabling framework, which to get the proper transformation into the sector, it's not just about the simple technical solution, but it's about providing an enabling framework that allows it to be sustainable and make real change. For a technical solution to succeed, it must be developed in parallel with four other themes of value assurance and digital, and it must be aligned with the wider programs already ongoing in industry and across the wider transforming construction network. It will need government and clients with the appetite and capability to ask for it, and industry with the capacity, capability, tools, products and solutions to deliver it. So this is all about building capacity and making sure that, as Raj was talking about earlier, that we can manufacture, that we can manage the requirements and the productivity and the expectations of delivery once we get large-scale factories up and running. The other key elements of our transformative program that we will accelerate to support the delivery of the CLC-led sector recovery plan and relate these to the framework. We're also creating a value framework, which works alongside some of the leading minds of industry to develop a new value framework that sets out to tackle key challenges. These are what we should be valuing, what we should be measuring, and how we should be using that to make decisions. Value should be measured by the broadest and longest set of measures with a clearer, most consistent approach to how decisions are made. It should consider both direct and indirect benefits as well as the whole life cost. This means thinking beyond the project and into the operational life of the asset. Crucially, it also means valuing the benefits and the impacts on a wider society basis, not just from the perspective of the user, owner and operator. And examples for this is, we've heard before about how it, the job creation and the impact on the area that it has. This also means considering how much carbon is produced in production, how much energy is used both in construction and operation, and how much waste we are sending to landfill, the emissions from transporting plants and materials to our sites, and how many jobs are created, how local communities are supported and empowered, etc. And there are many more. The hub has united with CLC to develop the industry-wide definition of value called for the construction sector deal. While the original title of Procurement for Value suggests a focus on procurement phase, this actually will yield a common approach to value underpinned by the Forum for the Future's Five Capitals model that can be used to support decision-making throughout the asset lifecycle. To ensure this work delivers maximum impact, however, we must ensure it also is accessible and possible. To this end, we have begun working on a new web-based tool which will help clients to articulate their value expectations and set performance criteria and compare scheme options from the outset in a way that can be designed, procured, measured and optimised through life. So this will enable those looking or considering schemes to determine which parts of the value measurements are most important and base their decisions on that. We also will have an assurance framework to ensure that new platform solutions, the assemblies and systems can be demonstrated to comply with regulations and standards and be able to respond to new demands from updated building regulations. The hub will help to develop an assurance framework to include both physical and digital testing in multi-component and 3D assemblies. And something we're looking at within BRE from the assurance side is how we use 3D modelling and graphics within the burner hall type scenario to understand certification of various components and assemblies. The assurance framework will include testing and certification components and systems, demonstration of performance data, approvals of suppliers' capability and quality processes and more. We will also look at working with financial institutes to ensure that access to finance, guarantees and insurance-based product supports wider rollout of these new solutions. We also need to test opportunities in 3D physically and digitally, and we need to ensure we're able to measure how they perform in service and in operation. Are they meeting those requirements? Are they delivering the value that we said they were going to deliver in the first place? And how do we actually make sure that people providing these are competent? We really need to ensure that the confidence that people making them, installing them and designing them are capable and behave in the right way. Under the digital framework, it outlines the data required for measuring against the value framework and demonstrating compliance with the assurance framework. The digital framework sets out what data is required to support decision making, performance measurement, and how it should be curated consistent with the Gemini principles within the UK for the digital twin. This will include developing the next phase of our BIM standards, driving an international program to ensure UK cements its world-leading position. We'll be working with the government and the NIC to drive adoption of the National Digital Twin and its principles throughout. Key outputs under the digital program and why we are saying BIM and digital is key to delivery of the platform, the kit of parts and the program are including supporting the, we will be looking under the next year or so to support the development of the digital ecosystem. This will be achieved through scoping the information requirements and the digital ecosystem, and by developing a seed foundation model, data model, that represents the relationship both between both physical and intangible entities within the built and natural environment. We'll also look at how we enable whole life information management and security mindedness to become business as usual. And we'll do this through seeking to address the barriers to information interoperability, including the recent release of BIM, the BIM Interoperability Expert Group report in March 2020 for anybody who would like to have a read. And I'll stick a link in for that as well. And this is a report which draws from the broader stakeholder categories of practitioners across clients, supply chains, technology providers and supporting organisations, and including academia. Other endeavours include informing and assisting the government in developing policies and processes and supporting the development and the promotion of the UK BIM framework, mostly led by the CDBB, but also in connection with BRE and MTC, in relation to the platform and killer parts models, etc. And developing additional guidance and tools for the government soft landings and information management. Also defining the digital BIM environment through working on and exploring and understanding what digital twins are and what they really mean and how we can deliver them. And also thinking about how we digitize the existing assets to incorporate them into that digital twin. Further outputs include developing supporting processes and an evidence base to change the way in which people, businesses and services interact with the market. So we're really talking about digital ways of working and determine the economic value of BIM and offsite construction backed by case study. So it's really making the case for everybody why we need to do this and how we need to change and what the benefits of doing that. And we've heard some of that today. A number of research projects at the University of Cambridge and its partners will also look at facilitating the digitization of offsite manufacturing. Part of this will be done through developing a campus facility management digital twin, and also how they can use satellite technology for infrastructure monitoring linked to the digital twin. Aligned to this are projects within BRE, which will look at standardizing the product data, which we've heard earlier about component data and the data libraries and how important they are to this process. And also thinking about digitizing and automating the checking of construction regulations. Other initiatives include the digital skills and training and understanding the requirements going forward for next generations of workers in the industry. Developing best practice framework for capturing and developing organizational information requirements. Supporting and guidance material for capturing and developing those OIRs, and also providing some pre-populated specimen OIRs, asset information, AIR, sorry, information exchange, and even an AIM folder structure. Guidance on generating and using functional requirements to inform the CDE specification as well are crucial. So unfortunately on this slide I had some pictures for you just to look at about the digital framework output, so we'll just skip those for now. You'll be able to pick them up later on, apologies. And really, so how do we turn this vision into reality? Together we look to bring together four technical strands to support the sector's deal ambition to catalyze improvements, not only in the design and construction process, the capital phase of projects, but also in the whole life performance of buildings and assets in the built environment. The solutions will be developed that deliver improved whole life value, better services, and support the delivery of broader social, economical, and environmental outcomes consistent with the industrial strategy, the construction sector deal, and construction 2025. Therefore, the hub is working to develop our platform program as a key centerpiece of our technical solution and to establish an enabling framework to ensure that the transformation of the sector can be delivered, it meets the needs of society, it is worthwhile for government and clients, businesses alike, but also, most importantly, probably it's scalable and sustainable. It's no longer just about outputs, it's about transformative impacts, and it's no longer about self-delivery, it's about co-delivery. So coming to the end of the presentation, the vision for the better outcomes are a higher quality and safer in creation and use, saving time and money, use of data and digital solutions to optimize performance across the whole life, delivering more society, more for society, users and owners. We obviously want to use less energy, create less waste and reduce carbon. We also want to enable new diverse skills and talent pools to attract the best to the sector. And ultimately, we want to support UK business to innovate, thrive and grow. And that's the end of the presentation. So my, as I say, my apologies. I have no idea why that's not worked.
No problem, Steve. You did a great job. No, you're fine. I mean, it's not the, the PowerPoint. The messages were really interesting. I mean, this idea of having this partnership between BRE, CDBB and MTC is really unique. I mean, how long is that in fruition now?
So we have a 4-year program. We're 2 years through the program. We have just over 2 years left to go. Yeah. It is very much seen as an initial stage of more stages or part of a process. And I think the understanding is when we can prove delivery and realize some of these benefits that actually there will be need for the continued support of that effort, which may lead to further investment. It's both from industry and the government, so it's a kind of matching kind. It's £72 million this time around, and hopefully we can keep pushing the agenda of the transformation.
So we're all very jealous of the funding you're getting in the UK. £72 million.
Yes, so it's so I've been in the industry for 35 years through various roles, including academia, and I was even involved in a very early DTI ICT enabled collaborative program in the late 90s, and I have never seen a figure like that associated to improving, transforming construction. So this really is the time to grab the bull by the horns and take the journey with us, and hopefully help and impact.